Feature Friday.
The freshest.
What's up, people? Welcome to Feature Friday. Welcome to Feature Friday. Happy Black Friday, even though, and happy Thanksgiving, too, to all who are celebrating it out there in the world. I'm thankful for you all. Oh. I hope you are all thankful for wonderful things in life, too, even though it's been a hard year. We all have things to be thankful for, so I'm thankful for you all and for my family and my brother. Okay, enjoy now your shopping. It's a good day to go shopping online.
It is, isn't it?
Dang it, online.
We're doing that.
Black Friday is so special to go shopping for queuing for hours. That's the best part of it all.
we were doing that last night. We were sort of buying stuff, you know, just buying stuff, really. And going like on a shopping spree, but online, it doesn't have the same effect.
It's so not the same thing. I felt like I was shopping for like a summer holiday. You know, like how you buy things for like a summer holiday before you go away. Felt like that's
what
like, I was
didn't feel
doing.
Like you were buying for Christmas or like any, you know, any Black Friday stuff.
I know. It's like, where is the fluffy boots and the hot chocolate on my hand? Where is the obnoxious amount of bags that I cannot hold in one hand?
Yeah.
Where is the people that I'm trying to shove with my elbows as I'm passing through in the mall?
I think the only thing I like about like having to shop at home or being forced to really, it's like Black Friday is quite a hectic day. It's very bizarre. It's nuts.
It's terrible. It's like Boxing Day here in England. Ugh.
I think Black Friday is probably worse.
Yeah.
But Boxing Day is not bad, but Black Friday is probably worse.
No, Boxing Day can get pretty bad in London.
Yeah, but Boxing Day, the sense of urgency for Christmas has already passed.
Good point. But now it's the sense of urgency to buy the best stuff for the lowest price is now it.
Best TV. You know? And now especially, it's going to be interesting with, you know, like PS5 release, the Xbox One. Is it Xbox S? I don't know. I don't follow that stuff anymore.
Me neither.
But
I've never followed it, really.
Yeah. So it'll be interesting to see how many people sort of, you know, are out right now in the computer sort of buying everything and stuff like that. Well, I mean, it was us. That was us until like 7 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, we didn't sleep at all last night.
Yeah,
so
we're just buying.
Yeah, it was a very bizarre night.
It was fun though. It was fun.
It was fun.
I decided to work out like at 3 a.m. in the morning.
Oh yeah, that also happened.
No, like at 2, because we were recording a song and we finished really late. Then I started working out. I got a little energy, so I started working out and then.
And then I was like, I'm not really that sleepy. Although I did get up really early. To do stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know why we didn't pass out until 7 o'clock in the morning. How did that happen? I don't know.
Well, I thought it was this was something that we had planned actually for quite a while.
Yes.
And we mentioned it in our live stream last Sunday, was it?
Yeah.
And we have planned to do more live streams. A lot of people are sending us messages because it seemed a lot of people enjoyed it. So it was really nice as well. And we enjoyed it a lot.
It was so much fun. I had so much fun.
So do keep a lookout. When we do live streams, we'll do like last time. We'll inform everyone. So hopefully, not everyone can join us. And but this was something that, like, the idea of Feature Friday was always this. Like, music from all over the world. A music sort of like... the discovery show to some extent,
basically
podcast. So it's
like a travel vlog, but for music.
Yeah, and you join. You know, it's a podcast where I really get
from the commodity of our couch.
It's a podcast where I really get to sort of, I don't know, swim in different music. I think swimming is probably the right word because it's so relaxing to me. And it's also like a sense of discovery. It's like if you were going to go scuba diving and you see like a different fish, you know? Huh? This is, I look at it, different artist, you know? But yeah, so we checked some of your requests and stuff like that and also saw what other fellow creators were sort of talking about regarding like music and stuff like that. And this was, yeah, it was bizarre making a list and stuff like that for this.
It was actually quite hard, I think. It happened also with the Turkish special. I think when we dive into a new country and their culture, their music and stuff, it's kind of hard to pick like a good variety of different genres and different artists that are staple for the country, because I feel like there are so many different things that make a country, and the music is such an essential part of it. So it's kind of, it's very hard to actually make a list.
Like a best representation of a, you know.
Yeah, it's kind of tough. So, you know, depending on whether you like this or not, we might do a part two and discover a bit more, you know.
It's more depending, you know, it's if you guys have other requests, then you're more than welcome to drop it down below and we check them out. And we just keep going. It's always been like this with every country we've done so far. It's always a matter of, there's always the surface, so the tip of the iceberg, and then deeper, diving deeper and deeper and deeper. And that's probably why we fall in love with so many different genres that we didn't even think we were going to fall in love with. It's because you keep diving deeper and deeper. So, like I always say, we read every comment. So, do feel free to send your recommendations or your thoughts about the podcast.
That's right. The skies are blue. Singing, and I gotta say, well, something to you today, and I'm afraid it isn't pretty. 'Cause lately I really don't feel the same when you hold my hand and call me baby.
Que el gusto completo, por eso yo lo meto en cuatro de retro, entero y neto. Perdona mi lengua, se enciende apenas te veo. Yo no creía en diosas, pero te juro que ahora sí lo creo. Toda cosa en mi cuerpo se pone contento. Tienes mi control, no lo lamento, pues así es que yo me siento. Comienza mi mente a pensar cómo se sienten tus besos. Hace años creo que lo llamaban matando queso. Pues yo quiero darte queso, telita y más de eso. Vamos pa'lante, despacito, pero no en retroceso. Déjame masajearte los sesos, verbal, física y mentalmente. Yo sí soy atento, yo escucho y te hablo lento. No te preocupes, no hay apuro. Y si lo hay, pues llegamos tarde a la misa y bien impuros. Sabes, los pecados me asustan, pero también te invito a comerlos con arroz blanco y plátano frito. A mí me encanta cuando tú gritas como un pito. ¿Listo? Ya se me acabó el rap. Pues en conclusión, yo soy el tipo, el huevo chalala, el último pichón, el maestro, el rey de los enanos, el que caga sin ano, el diablo más angelical, el tenista sin manos. Mejor aquí lo dejamos.
It's the perfect kind of day to break up with you. LACUNA COIL and Strip the Darkness, and I think this is rock.
Really?
Yes.
Well, this will be the first time I bloody watch rock.
That's a lie.
On the channel.
That's a lie. Because we did it for the Turkish special too.
It wasn't really rock though, is it?
Yeah, of course it was rock. It was rock.
Did we release that? Obviously in the podcast it was, but...
Yes.
Oh, bizarre.
Yeah. You liked it though.
Yeah, it was not bad. It was okay.
He liked it.
It was okay. I'm just not a big fan of rock, but let's give this a go.
That's so funny because when you were a child, like a toddler, you used to love that stuff.
Papa Roach, Disturbed,
System of a Down.
Blink.
Blink 182.
Who else? What
that's more punk than it was like.
What are the guys that sing With Arms? What are they? Creed.
Creed.
Creed. They used to like Creed.
You also used to like Nickelback for some reason.
Yeah. I think everyone used to like Nickelback as time went on. So just, I don't know.
They got a grad of it.
Look at these photographs.
Oh no, that's just me. 30 yeah. seconds to Mars straight me.
30 was you. 30 seconds, yeah, that was
30 seconds to Mars is definitely me. They're still my bread and butter. I still love them to this day.
Especially because of Jared Leto.
Oh my
that's,
god.
That's all it was.
Actually, the Leto brothers, both of them are pretty cool. But yeah, Jared Leto just stole my heart.
They're brothers?
Yeah.
Didn't know. I never knew.
That's literally...
The drummer.
Yeah, oh, the drummer right. and the singer are brothers.
He's a more quieter one in terms of, like, he's not always his in the public eye.
Yeah.
No, I'm not saying, I don't know, we don't know him.
No, but I think he's more like the musician type, and Jared is more like the actor, director.
It's funny because...
Everything actor.
He's always, he's been always very, like, active, regardless of, yes. of whether he's popping in music at that moment.
That's
he's always
right.
acting. If he's not acting, he's in music.
That's right.
That guy must have what a schedule.
Oh, it's crazy. Right now, they're busy with merch for 30 Seconds to Mars and stuff.
Oh.
They haven't released anything new, I don't think.
Well, let's watch LACUNA. Coil?
Coil.
Or Coil.
Coil.
Coil. Maybe it's just all in English.
Maybe it is. Who knows? But yeah, this is an Italian band, I think. So, cool. They're singing in English, I think. I'm pretty sure. Ooh!
Oh, it's going like heavy metal.
This is cool, though! Efra, this is banging.
It's in English. The drumming is hard as hell, man.
Ooh, we recognize that's them. Cool. I feel like
our we've sister had friends. Probably listens.
Yeah, we have friends that recommend, like, we probably have heard this already and we just don't remember.
Yeah.
But I
it
feel
sounds
like,
familiar.
Yeah, my sister and her group of friends definitely. They're yeah. definitely into this type of music.
Our sister earlier. Lives in Italy.
Yeah, and, true. Ah, totally true. Yeah. So
and,
weird.
And I think she's into this type of stuff.
Yeah, like, well, in the early days, like when she was younger, definitely this was her
it's
core
fair
essentials.
To say, our music taste, like between us three,
is very diverse.
Very bizarre. Like very it's diverse. Very weird. Mine is, you know, all the way hip hop, trap, R&B.
Yeah.
Yours is like experimental,
artsy, weird.
Yeah. And hers is like I'd imagine it's like this.
I yeah, mean, no, it is.
You know. Cause she,
so it's all like it's all weird. It's all we're so different.
Yeah, like everyone has such different tastes.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. So, yeah, well, I'd imagine she enjoys this.
Yeah, I think so too. I actually think I heard this when I was back in Italy.
Right. Oh yeah, you were there as well.
I actually think I know this, but yet again,
but they speak
do
in
I
English.
Really?
Like yeah. absolute English.
I actually think when I was back in Rome ages ago, maybe like how many years? Like 10, 11 years ago?
Yeah, about that.
About that,
probably,
right?
Yeah, probably less.
Something much. Like that. Rock was really in and like you could hear it in the radio stations and stuff. And like they were TV channels just only for rock. And same for other genres, but... What called my attention is like back home we didn't have that, like we didn't have like a radio station only for rock or a
you had
TV
Bonchona,
channel.
Which was like
it's like the top 40s for Venezuela,
yeah,
basically, and they would repeat the same songs all day every day.
Yeah, radio there was very general, like in Venezuela, radio is very general, sort of just was popping
generalized, yeah,
in Latin America.
Bonchona was hardcore merengue.
Or reggaeton,
right.
You know.
It was whatever was popping. Like, yeah. Whatever was popping in Latin America.
You never had genre radio. So that's
no.
Right, yeah. Go on.
So I always used to find that really, well, like, wow, that is so cool.
Yeah.
Ooh, that's so cool. Did you see the dark black and white?
Stop the
cat. Oh, that's cool. I like the cat. Stop.
It feels old school too, like, you know.
It does,
what I mean?
It does. Well, it's like it's 2011, so it's like nine right. years ago.
Probably one of the most fun genres to play in the drums.
Definitely. I think it's also one of the funnest things to sing.
Oh, really?
Yeah. This is so much fun. She's fantastic, though. Her voice is so cool.
Oh, they're singing to each other, kind of.
To like a different version of themselves.
Oh.
Imagine watching that live. It must be such a fun gig to watch.
You feel like jumping around?
Yeah. They get wild though. Rock concerts get wild.
I'd imagine you get pumped. Come to me. Come to me. Come to me. That's so catchy, what the hell? Yeah, this is not like past the point of enjoyment for me. This is good.
This is bang on.
Yeah.
Great music.
If it was to get heavier, I'd be like, whoa.
She's fantastic. This is so much fun.
That's heavy as hell.
That is so great.
Very
that
tight, man.
That was so great. I actually thought that was really quiet. Just turn it up a little bit.
Yeah.
That was so good. I really enjoyed that. I you know what I really like? The fact that the sweetness of her vocals was so opposite to what the whole band actually is. I really like that, and they work both vocalists work so well together. It's really cool. They used to be like, you remember that song? Bring Me Back to Life from Evanescence. I think that's what it's called. And yeah, I think it reminded me a bit of like that vocal dynamic.
What is it?
It's really cool.
Isn't that the point, right? That sort of bringing a female voice, which is a bit softer, a bit more melodic,
mm-hmm.
and then everything else is rough and strong and yeah, sort of harsh around it. But this is sort of that glistening glimmer of light.
So good.
That you know, in an obscure environment, that sort of brings a contrast musically.
Well, it they were obviously playing two opposites there as well, imagery-wise, in the video. You know, the black and the white, the opposites, and what it represents to be both in the same...
Trip the darkness. It's very difficult to focus on lyrics, actually.
It was so entertaining. Yeah, the whole thing was so captivating.
Like I'm spassy, like, oh, bloody hell. If I was playing the drums in that, I'd be like, so much going on, you know what I mean? Like, I need a third arm.
You become like an octopus, just to play all of everything.
I do agree. I do agree with myself. That is probably one of the most fun genres to play in the drums. I don't know how many people actually enjoy playing it in the drums, but it is very enjoyable, and it's one probably worth learning just for the double kick. What do you call it in English? Double pedal.
Double bass drum.
Yeah, just pedal. Just for the double pedal, really.
Action. The double pedal action.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know the lingo in English. Mm-hmm.
Tough.
Yeah, but yeah, anyway, so it is good. It's just that matter of, I think if it goes heavier than that, for me, that's what you sort of... Because
no,
it's not my taste, you know?
I believe that for most people that don't particularly listen to rock on it, like, often, I believe is the part when the vocals lose melody and they become a bit more aggressive. That's when people naturally become more detached. I think that's why rock this in this way with this type of melodics is so it tends to be commercial because anyone could be able to.
How many views does that have?
This has.
Well, that's
19 million views.
That is commercial enough.
I think so. I would say so.
That's a joke.
Yeah. All right. So we're gonna go to the absolute complete opposite next.
Right.
Because.
Oh Jesus Christ.
Yeah, because it is the absolute complete opposite. We're going to listen to Luciano Pavarotti, Nessun Dorma, because we cannot make an Italian special and not include a legend like this.
I thought we were going to add, obviously, Bocelli as well, Andrea Bocelli, but we've heard him before on the channel.
We actually have heard a lot of his music at home. So.
But I don't think I have heard like a full piece
Luciano
by
Pavarotti.
I have no idea if I actually have. So I thought this might be a cool.
Ooh, this is for me one of the most inspiring artists to watch. I watched a lot when I was training. Since I was young, actually, I used to watch a lot of opera singers. For the sake of vocal training, and I always used to get lost and mesmerized just by what was happening, rather than being able to pick out technique and actually do the homework that I was supposed to be doing. I'd be like, wow. So the whole time. So I'm really looking forward to see your reaction to this. I'm excited. So here we go.
Yeah, let's give it a go.
This was in 1994, so it's just a year before.
I wasn't
before
even born then.
I was born.
You were born in 95, right?
Yeah, just a year before.
I was born in the 70s. Puccini.
Yeah, that's the author of the...
Sounds like Puccero.
Ooh, listen to those to the choir. Oof. Oh.
He's got such an empowering sort of body language, isn't he?
Look how he prepares.
It's so weird. Why is that coming out of his chest? Diaphragm,
it is,
I should
it
say.
Is. That's a very good note. It's coming out of his chest. Like, the resonance.
He's like connected to like another world at the moment.
He is. But did you see how well connected to each word and how easily modulated it was on his mouth? The amount of work that is going through his body, the back of his body, the anchoring, how he's leaning forward very, very peculiarly, but the whole of his body weight is like right on his back. That airflow that's happening there is absolutely immaculate.
You know how some like vocal coaches and stuff, or like teachers, sort of say like you know, breathe with your diaphragm and all that stuff, and like sing with your belly kind of thing.
Yeah.
But you said he was singing with his chest.
No. So what I meant by that is that the resonance is coming from his chest.
Like, how do you make your resonance come from your chest?
So you
does
get
any natural come from your chest? So when I'm talking right now, isn't it coming from my chest?
Yes, but as some people, for example, me, my resonance doesn't naturally lie on my chest. Right. So I have to force myself to be more resonant by pushing my larynx down to reach further into resonance.
Am I pushing him down yet?
No, you're just pushing your jaw forward. Oh. That's a completely different maneuver, but yeah.
Jesus Christ, I cannot control my larynx.
So what
it's
I
like
do...
saying, I want my pancreas to do this. Am I, you know?
Well, in vocal training, to help you understand what's happening in your larynx.
I'm at a guess. Visualization.
Yes. Absolutely, 100%. So what you do is that you visualize the movement of the larynx, and naturally, by force of mental power,
really,
then you can, well, and a lot more trickery.
Yeah.
You begin to understand the movement of your larynx, and then therefore you are able to start understanding what to do to help them.
So you sort of like go into this state of hyper awareness.
Absolutely. You are so
you
aware
things.
Of your body. Yes.
Right.
Even the little modulation of the words, the tiny breaths, the way that you want to elongate a note, everything becomes heightened.
Right.
As you can see, he prepared so very subtly before he started singing, and the voice came out of nowhere. No, the voice came out of all that muscle power that is in the back of his neck and like the back of the back muscles. It's so cool because it looks so effortless.
I thought you were coughing. Oh, right.
No.
Yeah, I get it. Yeah.
For dramatic purposes,
yes,
only.
Yes, yes.
So yeah, it's pretty cool.
Theatrics.
Yes. I love him. He's amazing.
Yeah, he is. He has this sort of very like empowering sort of aura to him. Well, he is. He passed away, didn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, when did he pass away?
2007.
Yeah, so he was. Well, in that moment, he had this sort of empowering, like, you know, presence to him as his son.
He will forever be one of the greatest.
Yeah. Well, is it Dimash that also looks up to him or something like that?
Yeah, it wouldn't surprise me. I mean, he's one of the greatest voices in tenor speaking, yeah.
Yeah, cool. neck barely moves. No wasted movement, sort of.
No, so did you see how there was not a single movement of leaning forward, there was not a single movement of leaning back? The power that was coming out of those notes that were incredibly difficult to reach, by the way, in that type of resonance and in that vocal setting, are very dependent of the airflow and how he manages the airflow. So the non-movement and the hyper-awareness of the whole of his body created this box of resonance right inside of his mouth. So the soft palate lifts at the back of his mouth.
Right.
But everything up here becomes wider from the back into the front. So it becomes like a resonant box from a guitar. So it creates even more resonance, and the effort of the belting of reaching the higher notes becomes not so relevant, and it's all about the mastery of all those things together.
Right. So that's cool. That's why also it seems a bit like effortless.
But wow, there's so much effort going on there. I can tell you.
It's just very peculiar because most singers you see, they sort of like they move or whatever, you know, but he stayed so like steady. Solid. Yeah,
very
literally.
Grounded, a very grounded artist, yeah. Like
you're very unlikely you'll be able to push him away or something.
Absolutely, you probably won't.
But is he tense?
No, there's tension in the, I would say, the back of his neck, so the anchoring muscles underneath here, the rib cage and towards the back, perhaps maybe on the intercostal muscles wrapping around the back as well, perhaps, but nothing in the front.
His latissimus dorsi.
That's right. Yes, good anchoring, good engagement, but very little tension in the front of the abdominal wall.
I see.
Mm-hmm.
That kind of makes sense. Yeah, go on.
Magnificent. That's magnificent. Bravo. That's insane. Yeah. That's insane. I don't think anybody understands. Like, wow, that is insane.
It's so crazy. So the impact, like the effect it has on, I don't know, like that type of singing. Very rarely do you have singing that has a unique type of feeling. Like opera seems to have that feeling, that effect on people consistently. You know, especially the greatest to ever do it. It has this sort of I don't know. It's a moment of disconnect, but also connection with something else. You know, it's like this.
It taps into like a higher power.
But we were talking about this earlier, like, because I heard Joe Rogan talk about it in his podcast, where he mentioned the idea of good comedy doesn't come. You don't write good comedy; it comes to you. So it's like this idea of the muse or a higher power or whatever you'd like to call it, of creative power, right? And when you listen, I feel like only if you create do you kind of understand that concept, that you're just like some sort of receptor and you're not the creator of the signal. You're simply a receptor of the signal that comes to you at the moment, right time, whatever. But when you experience moments like those, especially if you're there live or even this bizarre experience that we have, and like, you know, you're watching us watch it and we're watching something, it's still there's some performances that, I don't know, allow you to understand that, like, there is something else at play, like, that something more, like, music has this weird capability of connecting past physical boundaries.
Absolutely.
And everyone there, like, in that room, in that arena, and here in this room, felt it. It's like you became elevated for a second, you know? It's so bizarre, the effect it has on your body, and those vibrations and sound waves, what they cause in your brain, and they change your state, mental and emotionally. Yeah. It's very bizarre. Like, it's very, very peculiar. And I find that it's probably, opera is probably one of those genres. Hence why it's been so, such a staple genre of humanity,
mm-hmm.
right? Of that type of singing. It's been forever. And it's been such a staple of humanity, because I think it is the only one that, because it resonates and like those vibrations are so unique. You don't hear them when you're out and about, just when you're out and about. You don't hear them in, those sound waves are not the same, you know? So maybe because they're such a shock to the system, or they just like the skill level is so high and, and there's also so high or so low,
yeah,
that they cause this like weird impact on you, you know?
I believe what makes classical music such an experience is the difficulty and skills required that it needs, you know, like what it demands from the human body. I believe that that's one of the greatest things that we have been able to discover, you know, how to make music to that extent and tap into emotions that they're not easily found.
Maybe that's why it does have that effect on other people listening, because it's like the maximal exertion of energy or the maximal exertion of, I don't know, power through music.
And and is such a delicate skill set that you get to develop, you know, whether you're playing an instrument, whether you're directing, whether you're the guy who holds a triangle, whether there is an amount of skill set that is so delicate and so specific that it is never done in a half matter to a mediocre standard. There is not a mediocre standard. So you either have to go through the whole journey and finish it until you get to this place.
Yeah, like that's one of those.
Or there is no middle ground.
One of those genres that you can't really half ask, can you? You either do it or you don't.
Absolutely, and I think that's what makes it such an experience, such a I don't know, groundbreaking scientific feel to it all. Like I think there is that's when classical music to me it's like an expression of science and magic coming together, you know? It's like mathematicians and magicians came to one room and decided to make a magic potion, and this was it, you know? I kind of believe like this is one of the hardest things that a human could possibly.
Yeah, I also like that's why I kind of, you know, I like hanging around with you watching this stuff, because I you know, broaden my knowledge, and I can only imagine what it's like, you know, for those coaches and you and people that genuinely know about singing, like what that must be like. It must have such a different impact to you than it has to me. Yes, we do, you know, we build ground, that common ground, on the fact that it has that effect emotionally and mentally on me, same as it did to you. But technically, like, I don't understand half of this stuff that's going on. Yeah. Is that the same as if you see a tennis serve? That's my type of art. Like when I see Federer serve, that's like, that's a painting. You know what I mean? It's smooth. Yeah, but the amount of technical stuff.
Yeah, of course.
The normal eye doesn't see that. It just sees a fucking fluffy yellow ball being hit over a net. You know? And other people might see just a guy singing really loudly. You know? But that's what I mean. That's why I enjoy doing this type of stuff as well, because it lets me then understand a bit deeper. And if I understand it deeper, it also hits me deeper.
So absolutely.
It's very enjoyable. Let us know if you'd like us to watch more like this type of stuff, because I love learning. I mean, Dimash is someone that we've covered plenty of the channel and we will keep covering. Lara Fabian, she's also bloody outrageous. And now I would love to dive deeper into Pavarotti and sort of go back in time, you know?
Yeah, definitely. I agree. This is gorgeous, gorgeous work. Anyway, so to move on, and I think this is more upbeat, this is totally different again. I feel like I've heard from both of these artists.
Oh, J-AX. I think that's how you say his name, or J-AX.
I think it's J-AX and FEDEZ. And I think I've heard from both of them again when I was back in Italy, but I don't remember this song specifically. Yeah, I wasn't in Italy by this time. So, we're going to listen to a little bit of something more pop, more upbeat, something more mainstream of Italian music.
I think that is pop. I'm not sure.
No, it definitely is.
It could be rap.
Well, like, 'cause I know you... but it's pop is
right.
Yeah, it's like popular music.
Because as you can kind of tell, we've tried to try and cover all the genres we could.
Yeah, it's like I said at the beginning, is difficult because there are so many great artists and they're all fantastic in their own genre and they all you know are also a staple to the country. So it's hard to pick. Yeah, it's news, hard.
Good news is there's always a tomorrow. You know, it's always another day. So
that's true.
You can always check out more music, and music is something I would never get tired of. Neither hearing or making, so.
That's a very good point. So I like
that. Doesn't matter
that.
If we don't call everyone.
Anyways, here it is, Italiana.
Italiana.
Why?
See, I said it in Italian accent.
In an Italian accent.
What the hell could be said? What is that? Oh, it's a Molotov.
Ah, I thought he was eating salmon. Something.
I thought he was eating a pigeon.
So did I.
We got translation.
No.
Curriculum.
This is fun. That's another thing in Italian TV and mainstream media. They can swear
good.
And stuff, and it doesn't get censored.
Good.
So
good
I think
them.
You would be having a great time in Rome, you know?
So in, hold on, say that again. Even in mainstream TV shows.
Yeah, in mainstream media.
Good morning, Italy.
Yes, you and can swear and they won't censor
it's
it.
It's effing prick.
Yeah, they won't
see,
censor it.
See, you see what I did? I censored one of the words to go past your... because you're the only person that censors me here.
And yeah, I because said a swear I word. Hate it.
Yeah, Jack, what is it? I'm FEDEZ. I'm going to find the...
Italiana.
The lyrics, just in case, you know, if someone's watching and they don't understand Italian.
Also, something that I love about Italian people, their fashion. Apart from their food, their fashion. Freaking love it, it's fun.
English.
Lyrics.
I wonder how many, if you're watching from Italy or you speak Italian, I wonder how much Spanish you'd be able to understand. Like if we play like Calle Trece, for example, because he speaks quite fast.
Yeah, no, it's too fast. It's like, no, I don't know.
But he's saying, bruh.
Bruh.
Discounted nation, they offer splits because here there are more leaders. I mean, I think because the words are actual insults in Italian.
Ah, and I see.
You can't really translate them.
I see.
You can't forget your first amnesia. Popular people this year will go to Mykonos to be hippie while smoking Oregon. Maybe it's maybe it's the happiness that played before. For these red eyes, there isn't an antihistamine. And then Donald Trump trains with Risicco.
Okay,
I'm not throwing a diss at Donald Trump.
No. But the whole diss. I remember that rappers and mainstream rap in Italy was very strongly against the government. So I feel like this is also a diss to the whole government.
If he isn't at the Pentagon, he is at the Polygon. And you're feeling afraid, at least, like when Fausto Brizzi asked for your curriculum. It did say curriculum. Keep the flag high. The Italian athletes are retreating in Formentera. A woman is true bad luck, but that's another story. I mean,
no,
hard...
a woman is bad luck, but that's another story.
Well, that's always said, but hard to kind of, because I guess this is literally translated.
I think it is, yeah. So it doesn't really make much.
So maybe I'll have to wait, because I know some of you will kindly drop like a bit of a meaning of the lyrics. So
I think it's a definite diss to like the higher power.
The system.
Yes, basically. Like it's like, F everything.
Yeah, good. I like the lightness, playfulness of it.
Yeah. It's such a summer tune, though. This is such a fun beat. I think it's they're just in the whole system from like the gossip, like the entertainment industry from the government. Everything that's wrong with the whole system overall, I think that's what it is. But in a playful way, because the track is so fun and uplifting, and everything is like a joke.
Do you not find that sometimes things that are a joke, or portrayed as in a satirical way,
yes,
hold more power sometimes,
absolutely,
or they're easier, they're more easily digestible.
I agree, though, and the message still comes across very strong.
It's almost very good at that. It's El Residente. Yeah, yeah. He's probably the best at it. Eminem is also one of the greatest at it.
These guys are on that level of satirical lyrics.
Yeah, it's very comedic, you know, very funny.
Yeah, like black comedy.
Yeah.
Fun. When was the last time you saw a Razer phone?
That's true.
A Razer Motorola. Oh, yes, oh my god, I miss Italian food right now. Oh my god.
They're very low-key hoodies, aren't they?
Yeah. Yeah. Totally gonna be on the low.
Oh, I would not find that attractive at all.
They're gorgeous ladies, though. Can we have a moment for that? Yeah, I think it's despite everything, the music will still carry on. I think that's what it is in the chorus.
Someone did that to me once. Like, they sort of did that bubble thing to try and be hot or sexy, whatever the lingo you want to use. And I was like, mate, clean it. You know, you have something in your face. You know what I mean? How is that attractive?
Oh, poor thing.
I don't know what she was trying to portray. Like, I can blow a bubble, you know what I mean? And then buff, it explode. I understand.
You do?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, mate. I don't want to be the one explaining to you.
Please don't. Yeah. I don't want to.
I understand, you know, sort of meaning.
Whatever
of it.
That means.
It's like slightly sexual, but it's like, mate.
Oh, no.
But it's like, you know, it's like a. It's all sticky. It's like, get it off. You know what I mean? And plus,
I think I'm traumatized.
Yeah, and also, when I was a kid, I always wanted to learn how to do bubbles, like those bubbles things with the chewing gum. And you could. I never could. Right? So now I have developed this childhood anger towards chewing gum bubbles because I can't do them and I still can't. And I remember everyone used to teach me, no, like make it flat or whatever and then put them around and then blow. I would blow and then the chewing gum would fucking fall. And then I needed another one.
Yeah.
You know, so.
You were one of those spastic children.
Yeah. I mean, I guess I was dumb. Everyone could do it except for me. And Venezuela has the best lollipop. Chewing gums.
Yeah, no, the best lollipops that had a chewing gum inside. That's what you meant to say.
That's exactly what I meant to say. And but yeah, I could never do it.
Yeah, it's funny. I was gonna move on from that.
Hey, she's very pretty. Good looking.
Italian people are gorgeous too, you know. Fantastic song. Loved it. Ooh, okay. I loved it. I really enjoyed that. I think it's lighthearted. It's fun. It gets a really cool message across. You get some, you know, pointers and digs at the system overall.
I guess, but it's like Italian girl. The summer you're searching for isn't far. You know, people fall in love for nothing. If you come from the sea, we are waiting for you, with water to the throat. We'll tell you an Italian story. You'll see that works. We'll stay away from you, and even if it rains, the music will play.
Mm-hmm.
That's the chorus, right? And then sort of the rest of it, you're kind of right. It's like, keep informing me of by fake news. We'll wait for Kim Jong-un's rocket.
Mm-hmm.
Beach dancers keeping fit, doing TV series, marathons, cooking books. Triangle and the Bermudas are the new republic.
Yeah, it's a diss to the whole... Well, at the beginning, I think it was a diss to the government and how they're handling, how they were handling politics in 2018.
They're poking fun at kind of the whole world.
And then and then the second verse, I think they were dissing the whole entertainment industry. Like, oh, you think you're doing something important when you're just dropping a cooking book and going to the Bermudas, you know? And I think it's cool. I like it.
Yes, away. It's fun. Poking fun is always fun.
It's fun, as long as you don't take it personal, you know? I think that's the other side of it. Like, some people...
Would you get pissed if someone was to make a sort of like a...
That song like that, and put me in it, and be like dissing me for some stuff.
But it was like a slight dig. It wasn't a diss song. It was a slight dig. But
just a slight reference. I think I would take it like a lighthearted fun.
Yeah. I mean, as long as it doesn't have evil intentions, is it? It's like...
As long as it's not like... Eminem and Nicki Minaj in that song, like, I don't think I'm fine. I'm fine.
Eminem, Nicki Minaj.
Yeah, with that Royce 5'9", what is it, like, when she was blowing up. I don't want to say the lyrics.
Oh, I see. I'd like as to long, stick my...
Yeah, so as long as
Nicki
it's
Minaj
not...
Nicki Minaj is behind.
So as long as it's not anything
like that.
That's not
like a dick, that's a compliment. In a very vulgar way.
Oh my god, how is that a compliment, you child?
Know, not at all, but I'm just saying.
No, I think I would be a little taken aback by that.
Right.
But if it's like lighthearted fan like this, like ah, ha 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 ha, like Valeska, I think I already have a thick skin by living with you. So
I'm sure there's really mean people out there, you know, so
I'm pretty sure, yeah. But if it's
not
like,
bad
it's like,
to build thick skin, that's a good skill to have.
That just means that you're gonna keep on carrying being mean to me.
Gotta train you, man. I'm only joking. Let's listen to this. I've been really looking forward to this because I chose this one. It's called Ghali.
Yes.
Ricci Dentro. Which Ricci I dentro. Which if I was going to translate that, it means the rich are inside, or inside is rich, or
I think the rich inside, I think.
Yeah. But I think that
so
would be
the
be
rich people on the inside, maybe, perhaps. Again, I guess this is going to be very,
what is
like,
that? Like,
lyrical.
A construction site.
Yeah, I think it's like, yeah, perhaps, I don't know. Go it's on. Produced by Charlie Charles.
Charlie Charles.
He's a singer as well, so we'll see some of his stuff later.
Really? Oh, yes. Awesome. Mm-hmm. Oh, it's more auto-tune.
Oh, you know trend. Who would be a cool feature here? Soaking.
New age rap, huh?
It's dope though, I like it.
Interesting choice of cars as well.
Bad Bunny as well would be good in this cup of songs.
Bad Bunny, Bunny, Bunny,
Bad Bunny,
Bunny,
baby.
Wow.
Ooh, cool.
That's a sick image.
That's cool, that's cool.
Dude, it would be so easy to snap on this.
Ooh, that's a gorgeous man.
Someone like Jill, dude, someone like Bad Bunny.
I'm telling you, Bad Bunny would be great. Soul King would be great.
No, no, no. Someone like, oh my God, what is his name? Oh my gosh, Bali. You're gonna absolutely...
Nicky Jam.
No, no.
No?
No, no, no.
I don't freaking know.
Gosh darn it. It would come back to me. But there's so many people that would absolutely snap.
Like, yeah.
Tory Lanez could also jump on this, like, Dope Man Gold type of flow.
Oh, yeah, good point. No, I think I would stick with my people, like, Soul King.
Oh, Soul King would absolutely murder. I think Soul King and Tory Lanez would make an absolute blow up of a song.
Oh, yeah, that would be good. That would be good.
I like this guy. He's very new age rap, so he's... Depends.
Find the lyrics. I have so many questions. He was talking about somebody's son in a reality show, and, you know, talking about...
Oh, yeah, Valeska can kind of understand a bit of Italian.
Not anymore. I'm really rusty out of practice. But when I was there, I could hold a conversation about bread for like a good 2 minutes. I felt very intellectual, very cultural.
May I ask, why bread?
Because I used to go to a... So bread, like panaderias, how do you call them?
Bakeries.
So bakeries in Rome would never close, right? So they would
what?
And they like throughout the night they won't close, so they would stay open the whole night, at least when I was back there. And so, and my sister used to come from work really like very early in the morning, so like around 4:15, and that's when the new batch of like fresh
bread
and pastries and cornettos and stuff would come out.
Cornettos and ice cream.
No, cornettos are croissants and stuff like that, but the Italians.
Oh, right.
The Italian ones.
I see.
So good. So, yeah, so we used to go to the bakeries at 4 o'clock in the morning and eat pastries at 4 o'clock in the morning with very strong coffee. And it was a vibe.
What the hell do you... I mean, yeah, you're sleeping and then you wake up really early, I guess. You.
No.
They would come back from work.
Yeah, so...
You would be...
So I would probably would have slept the whole night.
See,
so I just woke up when they were coming back.
So he's saying, Dad, I'm having so much fun. I haven't heard from you in a while. Mama, come on, be sincere. You didn't expect all this, did you? We were already rich on the inside. My God, it feels so good to tell you. I told you. I haven't heard from you in a while. Mama, come on, be sincere. So that repeats twice. And then he says, my father was a big scoundrel.
Scoundrel.
Scoundrel, that's what I said. My mother did nothing to raise me. Not bad. That kid is going to make it big. Grown up before the right time. Success is like a Ferrari. You need to keep the speed high, create your own path, and get sly.
Ooh, go sly. Slimy.
Get sly, wow.
Get sly, ah, I like that. You gotta be like strip smart. Strip smart.
You talk too much. Recap for me. This year I'll vote for I don't know as well. This year I'll vote for I don't know.
I don't know. I don't know.
What will I say to my kids? Tell me something I don't know. Your kid is on a reality show.
That's the part I picked up.
Right.
Okay,
it's very new age rap. I mean, it's short lyrically. It's, you know, it's kind of limited, but it's more sort of like it's a whole idea of cadence, rhythm, and catchiness. You know, selling.
And I also feel like these are like very young people relatable lyrics as well. Like I feel like anybody in their 20s would relate to those lyrics. Like, yeah, I also vote for I don't know who I'm voting for, or you know, like, get straight smart. Make your own success, don't depend on anybody. I feel like those are lyrics that relate to younger people. Like,
yeah, I mean, this is also the interesting bit about...
It's very Generation Z.
Sure. It's very interesting about, like, you know, this new rap and the whole mumble rap culture and all this stuff, right? Which doesn't actually mean they mumble. It just means what they talk about. It's all over the place. And not specifically lyrical, but... What's interesting about it is that when you're 21, 22, or 19, 20, up to probably until you're 26, you're a mess up here.
You're still mumbling
up here.
Yeah,
you're basically just mumbling your way through life, tumbling, trying not to fall, you know, and you're still building opinions. You think you got the world figured out, but you really don't. You know what I mean? Like, it's obvious you don't.
Actually, you spend a lot of the time thinking that you do, and a lot of the other time, the other half thinking that you don't. So
exactly. And then growing up and actually maturing is that slap in the face that you don't know much, mate. You know what I mean? You actually don't know as much as you think. But when you're, and I imagine for these guys that they have blown up and they have a platform and a reach, and they also have money, and they're inside this very peculiar industry of music, which I obviously have my opinions about, and I'm sure other people do, and you think you have to become a different, you have to develop a different type of intelligence because you didn't go the traditional route.
Mm-hmm.
So a different type of intelligence is needed for this one. So it's that's sort of what they call street smart or sly or sort of aware or woke or whatever, you know? So it's very interesting that, and that's why the topics and themes that all these new rappers are talking about are similar, because the realities that they go through at that age as a new upcoming rapper that is seeing some money, not as much as you think, but they're seeing some money, and they talk about similar topics because it's you know, similar environments, similar
is their environment, exactly, is what's surrounding their day-to-day life,
right? And it's limited to their what they can see
their
at
perception,
that specific moment.
Of course, absolutely.
I'm actually sure when you see all these rappers that maybe
a few
people
years from now, yeah,
consider as mumble rappers or rappers that are not specifically lyrical, they're more just about beat production and visuals and cadence. In 10 years time, I'm sure when they look back at their creations, they're gonna be like, I wish I knew what I knew, what I know now, and I could speak to this, you know, to this kid making music.
Absolutely.
You know, so it's interesting, and you can't deny, like, this has a time and a place to absolute bloody bang.
I think this is all. I like the song.
Yeah,
I like the song. I like this artist too. I think it's cool.
It bangs.
It's such a bop though.
That's on fear.
It's
a nice jacket. Oh, jump.
Ooh, cool.
I'm telling you, man, so many people will snap on this.
Oh, this is such a great song, though.
I'd love to
everything.
Snap on this shit. Tell him my pain and I'm peeping, I'm peeping, I'm telling him. Oh, come on, dude. It's such a fat bit. Oh, my gosh.
Ooh, it's cool. It's fire. It's dope.
Tell him I'm peeping.
Dope.
Oh, my gosh. Tutto questo. And you would have to say a whole lot of bottle, a whole lot of nothing, and it would still slap. You could say a whole lot of nothing on this.
I'm wearing my jacket, I'm wearing my toes.
Yeah. I'm wearing my jacket, I got 50 in my toes, I got 50 in my line, I'm hitting my rose, and everyone would be like, whoa!
He be on fire!
You know, because the beat is so fat.
It's great. It's great. I like it.
If you amp up the bass, like if you've got the capability, if you don't own an iPhone, is what I'm saying, and it allows you to download an equalizer and amp up the bass, because iPhone, for some reason, doesn't allow you to do that.
You can equalize it on your...
On iTunes. You gotta be on the computer. On the BS. But on my phone, like Android, obviously, you can just download an equalizer and amp up all the bass.
Spastic phone.
And explode your eardrums.
It's so stupid.
You know? But Apple doesn't allow you to do that for some reason.
Because they're smart.
How?
Moving on.
Dude, amping up the bass is always a good thing. Or
no,
amping up the
highs. No, it's not. Because you can never... Okay, let's talk about your equalization on your phone. In your phone, you can only hear the boom, zombie, and the voice is like drowned by all the
right
bass.
At the back. Like, I just like the beat.
Like drowning.
That's how I listen to Lil Mosey. The more I hear the beat, less I hear him.
I'm like, why does it sound so off? Like, what is wrong with it? And then I see your equalizer is like no mids, no highs, all bass.
Yeah, 6 decibels plus on bass, -7. In highs and mids, it's just lows, basically.
It's just...
I'm sure if my doctor has a look at my ears, they'd be like...
No, actually, the bass is not as harmful.
It is. No, 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 no.
The bass...
New studies have shown that actually is the bass that's the problematic one.
Oh, you
not
idiot.
The highs. Everyone used to think it was high decibels. High frequencies, sorry, but it's lower frequencies, which are very dangerous. Yeah, so I'm
gonna all gonna be deaf by the time we're 60. Let's go. Okay.
Next one.
Right. I love this new age of music. Ooh. Oh, okay. Okay, 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 okay. Yes, yes, yes. I'm so excited for this.
Another radical change.
Yes. Like I said, we're trying to go as for many different genres, for so many different artists. So don't diss the cocktail of music right now.
No one's dissing. It's pretty fun.
Okay. Yeah. Good. I'm glad you're having fun.
Yeah, it's because it's crazy. Like we've heard opera and then new age rap and then rock, and
that's
now
true.
And then more rap and then this.
Yeah, so here we're gonna have my absolute top favorite singer, female singer ever, since like the most influential female singer in my whole of my career is Laura Pausini, and of course Lara Fabian together. So this is like. You're talking about two absolute vocal queens here. Like, super renowned, well-respected in the whole world.
Yeah.
I think these girls, well, these women, have...
How old are they now? Laura Pausini, how old is she now?
I don't have an idea. Can you check for me, sir? Thank you.
I'd imagine she's probably past 40.
I think so. She's some... I don't really know.
I'm going to guess 46.
And Lara Fabian, I think she's like maybe
51.
50 something.
She looks great though. Whatever
they
age
both,
she is.
They both look absolutely stunning.
I haven't seen Laura in years.
Oh, you can see her in the new The Voice in España.
Oh yeah, that's true.
She's
just... Oh yeah, she looks the same.
She looks exactly the same.
Yeah.
Anyway, so yeah, the two of them are singing La Solitudine.
She's
43.
46. Laura, hey, my guess was
Laura,
right.
Laura Pausini is 46. And Lara Fabian?
She's probably, 50.
I love them. I think they're so... They've marked me, both of them. But Laura Pausini has definitely been, I think...
Well, since you were a child.
I think she consolidated my ideas of becoming a singer, you know? You know when you're a kid and you grow up, singing and stuff and doing things, and you think, oh, I have to figure out what I'm gonna be, you know? When you reach 11, 12, people start asking you questions of, well, what do you want to do when you,
It's also the time in sports where you if you really want to do it, that's really when you make the choice. At 13, 14, to then try and go pro. It's the same with singing. It's like, are you gonna make this your life or not?
Well, I remember I made that very conscious choice when I was 10 years old, and it was 2006, And Laura Pausini had just released her album, Canto. Io Canto.
Is that the one that has Tiziano Ferro in it?
Yes. And yeah, that album definitely marked
changed
my
your life.
Yeah, it made me take the conscious choice to pursue singing as a career. And yeah.
Yeah, me too. The one that made me want to sing opera was Eminem's Relapse.
Wow. Wow, so artistic.
Wow. No, I'm only joking, but yeah, that was an album that literally marked you. And I think marked the whole house, because it was like, oh shit, she's taking like...
This is serious.
Yeah, like, no, she's going to take... No, because it's not that it wasn't serious before. It was very serious before. Genuinely serious, but it comes to a point...
I think it was like...
Where you're hitting teenage years.
Yeah, I had to make a choice. And not that anybody was pushing me or to make a choice or anything. It just became clear. It just became clear that that's what I wanted to do the rest of my freaking life.
and it's also like, it's the same in sports and arts. It's like when you're 13, 11, 10, that sort of age, those 3 years, right? You're starting to then finally, that's it, yeah.
Lara Fabian, yeah.
50? Ooh, I said 51.
She looks absolutely stunning,
yeah,
though.
She's 39.
She is gorgeous.
When you're that age, 10, 13, right? And you've been doing this since you were a really, really young child, really young kid. And let's say you experience some, a fair amount of success coming up as in the child industry, I guess.
Entertainment industry, you mean?
Yeah, entertainment. It sounds wrong, is it?
Yeah, it sounds very wrong.
Your child entertainment industry. And then at 10, 11, 12, you're starting to develop then your actual true personality. You're starting to discover, hold on a second.
Your likings, yeah.
I don't like doing this, or I do like doing this, or I like more skateboarding than being in a TV show.
That's
or
right.
I like more karate than I like being in a bloody TV show.
Yeah, and then you started seeing the people around your own age group that had decided to not do it anymore.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, I don't think this is for me anymore. And people, you know, and older, the people that you used to look up to that were, you know, that grew up with you in the entertainment industry, telling you about all the disheartening moments of the whole industry. And then
it starts,
you know,
to look a sparkle.
Yeah, I know. And it becomes a job. And I think that's why that album,
yeah,
that Laura Pausini's album, just like repolished that childhood dreamed.
Yeah.
And dream and made it a possibility, you know. I don't know why, it just hit me so strongly.
Also, when you're 10, 11, 12, you start to realize kind of like money, slightly.
Oh,
it's
I
not
never,
yours.
I never got to that point. I was 20 and I still didn't understand the concept of money.
But I did, and I saw it happen to my friends. I mean, maybe it was just unique to us, I don't know. But when you're like 10, 11, even when I was 9, 10, 11.
Maybe it's like a boy thing.
12, I don't know. You start to notice that the things you do, like, come with a reward.
That's right.
It's that, oh, so if I do this more, I can buy more cool games.
Or more cool clothes.
Yeah, I don't see the money. You know, the parents have it and stuff, and then they give it to you and all that stuff. But you start noticing stuff. My time is worth something.
That's right.
So, but then you also notice, like, all the, you know, the people you look up to when you're, that are 10, they're like probably 16 years old.
Yeah,
you know?
They hate life already just by being 16.
Yeah, you're looking at them like, dude, this is bloody perfect. Why are you sad? You know, but then
they tell you like some of the realities.
Up. They got caught up in the idea of this had to be your life because you did it since you were 3.
Exactly.
When in reality, it really doesn't.
Hey, you can
you
have
a
chosen,
choice.
Yeah.
So it was an important moment at the house, in the home, that you genuinely chose, I want to sing, without anyone telling you, okay, let's take it to this academy or this place or this place. You were like, oh my gosh, this is really what I love doing.
Yeah,
and
when the opportunity arose that I could actually go to Italy to study singing, oh my God, that was like the greatest thing that, like, I knew for the moment in time that I was going to make it. And
yeah.
Like, it... 14-year-old me thought, I'll go to Rome, I get signed, I'm a star.
Yeah.
It was so good though, but I wouldn't change it for the world. I think that was one of the greatest experiences I've ever.
Well, then
did.
You ended up like, you know, basically in the next door neighbor. So saying, you know,
basically,
London.
Yeah.
So it's such a, because that's the thing. Like, if you decide to then make singing your career, it's very unlikely it's gonna go to plan.
Of course,
like,
not.
Like,
nothing,
this is step one, two, three, four, five. It's always...
There's not a recipe. Like, there isn't a recipe.
It's always step one and then 1.2 and then 1.3.
It's like detour, recalculate the route.
Yeah, it's always... Like, with every career, it's like that. Sports, you know, arts, even in university, you know, even after you graduate. Because the thing about university is that it's quite structured and planned.
Yeah.
Which, that's a huge benefit to the educational system. It's planned, it's structured. It makes you do things you don't want to do. But it forces you to make them. If not, you don't get the thing you want at the end.
That's
it's
right.
The important part of it. But after that, it becomes free roam.
Yeah.
You're out of a system now, so now you got to figure out what's what. You know, so it has its what do you call it?
Benefits and...
Pros and cons.
Yeah.
You know, the thing with arts, though, is that it's free roam from the beginning.
Yeah, from when you...
No
yeah.
one bloody knows.
From day one. From the second you start earning money from this industry, it's all...
It's game on.
Yeah, it's all fight for yourself.
Yeah. Let's watch it.
So this is Laura Pausini and Lara Fabian, La Solitudine.
Which means the solitude.
The solitude.
That's what I said.
This is old. This must have been like in 2002 or something. Yeah, definitely 2001, the whole aesthetics.
She virtually looks the same.
She looks exactly the same person. Yes, girl! She's like my Bible. Bible.
You pray to her.
Basically. I actually think I walked there.
Really?
Yeah, I think I have pictures in that fountain.
Oh, nice.
Oh my god! That is so cool!
That's a cool
okay.
fact.
Oh! I love her.
Yeah, you've definitely walked there if you've been. Wow.
Bravo! Oh, gorgeous! That's gorgeous!
Damn.
This is gorgeous!
That is such a Laura song.
It is her song.
Yeah. The progression.
Oh, it's gorgeous, it's fantastic, this is perfect.
Wow. Yeah, it's so Laura.
I love her so much. Oh, it's gorgeous. That's fantastic. It's fantastic.
It's a good shot as well, like having them like that.
Yeah, it's cool. That overlay is so cool. Oh my god.
That's a G.I.
Bro. I'm gonna cry. That was so good.
That's a G.I.
That was really good.
Oh.
I love her so much. All
the influx of memories and stuff.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Influential. Bible. No, for real. That is crazy. I am lost for words. I love her. I think she is one of the most incredible people that's ever existed in the face of the earth. But...
what makes that so special is that you get somebody who has such a different vocal texture, like Lara Fabian. She provided that velvetiness with strong power vocals and her touch, her natural inflection to the song, which gives the whole performance so much depth, you know? What I find difficult is when artists collaborate and they sing a staple song from one artist, like from one of them, like say that it's your song and I'm coming in to sing one of your staple songs.
Sure.
I find it is difficult to match the energy, you know, to match what the song naturally requires. There's already such a high expectation from such a big hit. So having somebody so iconic like Lara Fabian to come in and give her touch, her depth and versatility, do such a beautiful song that is so staple of Laura Pausini. It's magical. It really provides such a magical performance. And obviously the location that they picked is perfect. Everything about it is fantastic. It just brought me back to my days of roaming around in Rome.
Yeah.
La, 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 look, I found that a student.
it's certainly, like, it was certainly magical, like, you know. Yeah. And I think I probably, if I don't know, by any chance, if any of you were present during that or you watched it live or whatever, it must have been one hell of a day or night, you know, because it's very special when two such talented individuals come together and share the stage or share the microphone, you know. It's very
That's so special.
Very special, yeah.
That was so special.
Very, very special. And like, it's harder as well. Like, when you're watching your favorite singer, it's hard for other people to understand, like, what he actually means to you.
That is so true.
You know? So, I can't imagine what you're feeling, you know?
Yeah, it's emotionally very, very, very deep into it. Very invested.
Yeah, she was just so played at home, and she was regarded in the house as someone who was a someone, not who was a role model, but somebody who you had to aspire to be like, because she had done so many things correctly.
That's right.
You know, not only in the way she handled her personal life, but fame and wealth, but also her artistry and the way she was able to still be connected to who she was when she first began writing to when, you know, she's took over the world. Because there was one moment where literally everybody, you know, knew Laura Pausini as like she was like the Ariana Grande of the moment, but just like
in Hispanic music. Yes,
exactly. Yeah, you know, Latin America, everyone, bro, like, yeah. Laura Pausini would make everyone cry, would make it, you know. And I'm sure she still does. I mean, she's obviously a huge name, that's why, yeah, she gets invited to shows and stuff like that, and but she would always hold that dear place in this home's heart.
I agree.
Because because of what she, the impact she had in you, you know?
Very special. Very special. Yeah. Again, we're going to move on. Once more.
Yes.
To a completely different thing. Oh, we're going back to that pop. Oh, stop it. So rude. We're moving on to something more pop, different. But I don't think it's pop. I think it's rap. This is Charlie Charles. This is the guy that produced the beat for the song before.
Yes, Ricchi Dentro.
Ricchi Dentro, that's right. No, so no. So he's gonna be singing this, has one.
This has Comey, Stefara Evasta, Tedua, and Ghali, who we're familiar with.
And Bimbi. Bimbi, Easy. Featuring Easy.
Right, I see.
No, I think the song is called Bimbi. This is fun. Ooh, Charlie Charles, Bimbi.
Sono quattro.
Skrrr! I'm telling you, Bad Bunny, baby! He will be so good in this type of stuff. Oh my god! That slapped hard!
That bangs!
He looks so sad! Why do I look so sad?
Maybe that's his aesthetic. I'll check the lyrics in a second.
That's really cool.
Feel.
It does.
Hey. Fashion wise, it's very, very clean. It's like nice, I haven't seen yet in this sort of like a few rap videos we've seen. Here it's more about sort of drip. Right? And
the sauce.
And yeah, brand names. And also sort of how crazy it looks. You know, how sort of like extravagant.
Yeah.
Fur coats, long coats.
What, do you mean in grime? In the UK?
No, not grime. I mean hip-hop in general. Not here in the UK. I mean hip-hop in general, like outside of Europe. So American rap or it could even be, I guess, UK rap to some extent. UK grime is very different, though. Where it's actually all about Nike and it's very similar. If you've ever seen French grime, it's very similar to French grime.
It's true.
Very similar to Australian grime. The way the fashion works, it's actually not.
It's more about the whips, like the cars and stuff.
Yeah, and
it's
not
so much about what they're wearing. Yeah, to be honest.
It's more about the brand of what you're wearing. It could literally be a tracksuit, but if it's like a Prada tracksuit, everyone's like, oh, it's nice. You know, and I have my opinions. I don't like tracksuits. But here it seems it actually has a...
like a music video vibe. Yeah. Like a whole thing, yeah.
I'm more fond of this idea because it's more congruent to the whole video.
It's
and more colors
artistic. And... I feel like even if you didn't like this like as a genre of music or you weren't a fan of these people, you would appreciate the video regardless, you know? So I think that's this
just winning.
Well, I don't
know, but that bloody beat bangs.
Yeah, it wouldn't surprise me that it was produced by Charlie Charles too, because he is a producer too. So, you know, it'd be cool. I've seen his name come up in different people's songs as well. So it wouldn't surprise me that he made this beat himself.
Well, I can't
find them in English.
Translation.
Oh,
gossip.
That is annoying. No?
No.
Oh
yeah, I got it.
Oh, okay.
She says, I'm growing up bad or maybe not. I don't understand well or you are. I'm always surprised by everything. I'm always darkened because I know if I start to write, it's already 6 o'clock. I turn off the candle. I turn off the incense. Ooh. I turn off my head and everything it has inside. I faint on the bed. Yes, like it was a disease. That's not how you spell disease. We are some stacks, some empty stacks. I pour 20 empty stacks on the block notes, swollen river, chains of Evian? What is that?
Avion.
I've never heard of that word. Yes, I take
maybe
with me
brand.
My roots. I'm dead so many times to forget who I was. I must find myself. You have bruises on the phone. No, not like me. I have a draft on the phone. You have some muscles, but on your head. Right, okay, so it's
things get lost in translation, and it's hard to, like, because these things sometimes get lyrically translated, but not for the sake of making sense of the phrase. So you lose a lot of, like, the essence of the song sometimes when you find translated lyrics.
But I think also it's kind of meant to, not meant to be lost, but I'm saying it's going to be a bit mumble-jumble because it's like his thoughts, it's like his 3M thoughts.
I see.
You know, it's him basically verbal vomiting. So he's saying, you don't know me, I'm worse in reality. What I have in my pocket, I spend it and sometimes it's wrong. It's impressive outside. I try to make peace at home.
Brr, brr.
You know, the friend's dreams is a random land. So it's difficult. And a lot of it is getting lost in translation. Because I don't know if it's like a website that tries to translate it or if it's actually someone who wrote the translation.
So let us know what, like, the whole, perhaps the intent of the whole song.
Yeah, more importantly,
context of it all, yeah. Let's carry on. I really like it, though. I like the aesthetic of the music video. I think it's pretty dope. Ooh!
Jesus.
Oh, my God.
I like him.
He bangs, though. And I love what he's wearing too, like this is fire. Look at the scenery though, that's sick, sick set. That's dope. I appreciate that very much.
Pretty fast, dude. Hey, bangs, dude.
This is dopeness.
I'm not surprised, it does well.
Oh!
Oh, this is fire! Oh, he brought a whole different flow. I appreciate the imagery, the models, the layout, everything here is dope. That was fire! Okay, though the visual director needs all the praise in the world because they made it so sick.
Charlie Charles, a hard ass photo, dude. Look at that photo.
Yeah, that's dope.
The profile photo.
Sickness! That was so cool. I appreciate that.
That's probably going on my playlist.
That is sick. Well, you know, that could play after a Soul King song.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Dude, you know what? So weird now because, like, if I plug my phone, like, in someone's aux cord, it will have music from all over the world.
Like, and they're like, what are we listening to?
No, and they'll be like, I've never heard this song.
It's like, yes, because...
And I'm like, how? Yeah. That song has 112 million views. And then they'll be like, what? I'm like, yeah.
Yeah.
And then, I've converted them. It's happened with Korean
conversion
rap.
Happened
with French, like especially French rap, dude. All my friends adore French rap now.
Adore it.
So I'm more than down to do a French hip hop special.
Ooh.
Now I know so much more.
A brand, a whole new world.
Yeah, that's pretty good. I like all of that stuff, man. Like it's the thing about like the thing about hip hop is like whether you like it or not. That's whether you like hip hop. That's kind of determining if you're going to like a song.
That's true.
Or not. And then also, then it more importantly, it goes whether you like, what type of hip-hop do you like then? Like, do you like lyrical hip-hop? Do you like lyrical rap? Do you not like lyrical rap? Is it more about beats, cadence, and stuff like that? There's everything for you nowadays anyways. And I think that's what's so good about the internet. It's like you can literally find anything you want that accommodates to your taste. You no longer have, like, I don't understand why people watch stuff that they don't like to watch.
That's true.
It's like, why the hell are you know what I mean?
Why are you watching?
It's like torture.
Like, just move on. Find a new video. Something that you actually like.
People make, my friends make fun of me because I'm not a big fan of the whole, like, scrolling on any app. Like, Instagram, I don't have TikTok. I do have TikTok, but I don't use it. That's a long story. But, so I don't do any of that stuff. So, and they kind of make fun of me because it's like, oh, you know. But I'm like, every time I scroll... It's always something that I hate. So, oh my gosh, what I waste my time. And it makes me feel bad after. It's like, why did I waste my time watching that? It's like probably some video of some person, like, they do that and then they clean the window and then they pretend to be all attractive. And it's like, mate, get off my phone. Just get off. You know what I mean? I don't want you here.
Poor people doing the wipe challenge.
Well, whatever. If that's what you like, that's what... But I don't like that. So I'm not going to, like, press this. Like, well, I just don't even...
interact with it at all.
You know what I mean?
Find something.
Yeah, because fair enough.
Like.
And they're obviously doing well. Like, a lot of millions of people love what they're doing. So I must be the anomaly. But I just accept that fact and I don't even scroll. You know, let them be. Like, who cares? get that money. Do the swipe thing. You know, do the whole ice bucket challenge. You know? Whatever it is.
If I got stuck in 2010.
I think I stopped scrolling on Instagram and all that stuff. And, like, when I got out of high school.
When was that?
2015. Yeah, isn't it? Yeah, 2015, I don't know. You know, when I started traveling and stuff like that and just being beat, like, mate.
Enough.
I would find myself, obviously, I'd find myself scrolling every now and then. And then I'd hate myself after. I'd be like, oh, it's long. Why did I watch that?
I literally can spend hours. I enjoy it so much.
And the worst one.
I find it fun. Like, the ones I don't like, I just scroll through until I find something that I like. And
the worst one is when I find something I like, but can't have.
But what?
Can't have in that specific
moment. Ah, so it usually becomes...
like food.
Pancakes, yeah.
Like food, bro. There's a whole niche about food pornography.
Oh, yes, yes.
You know, it's not adult videos. It's just sort of like, you know, very well-made food, I guess.
Very well-made, pleasing food-making videos.
Yeah, and it's like...
Sorry.
And it's like... you watch it, but then you can't have it.
Yeah.
Or you, oh, look, they've got this nice hotel in Thailand, and you're stuck in lockdown.
That's true.
So why would I watch that? Why would I want to torture myself?
Yeah, see, I don't enjoy. I never did. Not even when it was trendy. Like, the whole travel vlogs and stuff, I never enjoyed them. Like, I always found them a bit pointless.
But like, why am I looking at pictures of the Bahamas and people having the blast, while I'm here in my sofa just, you know, cocooning because it's so cold outside? I do not enjoy that experience.
I agree and disagree.
So?
I agree and disagree. I agree because, yeah, okay, fine. But I disagree because...
Because? It's good for mental exercising.
Nah, man. It's good planning.
Materialize your thoughts. Make it happen whilst you're visualizing it.
Well, where you do that, book a ticket. But I'm just saying...
Yeah, but if you're broke, you cannot book a ticket.
Sure, but I'm just saying it's good for, like, tourism and stuff. I think that it's been great for that. Because you can, I like this place. I'm going to visit that in the near future.
I see.
And if you don't have the money, I don't know. Maybe try and find something similar to that that's maybe more around your budget. Now you have literally videos on any location on Earth.
Basically,
you know, like cheap. And now with websites, you can find cheap hotels or cheap, like, flights and stuff.
Yeah.
The internet is one hell of a hole, man.
It's awesome. Yeah. It's awesome. But
scrolling through.
But you know what I really do enjoy that I genuinely, like, adore spending time watching is the cooking videos. Like, people cooking or making recipes and things like that. Baking and making cakes looking pleasingly attractive and stuff. It's so cool. I love it. And I don't get hungry either. I just enjoy the amusement of watching people cook.
Yeah.
Even though you hate it. You're like, oh my God, Valeska, you're going to get diabetes through your screen.
Yeah, yeah.
I was the other day, I was just chilling and everyone could see the screen from where he was standing. He was like, Valeska, you're going to get diabetes through the screen.
Because Vale is on that ketogenic stuff. Like, you don't eat any sugar or carbohydrates.
Uh-huh.
And I guess the way you cope, it's like watching.
It's not like how I cope. It's not like I need it. But I like watch, because those, what are the things that look the most good on the internet?
Yeah.
What are the things that look the best?
Fat donuts.
Filled with Nutella that when you crimp them all open, they're all like spilling with yumminess.
Or macaroni and cheese, like the nasty one.
You know?
Yeah.
Or like the juicy burgers that have like 3 buns and like so much cheese.
Yeah, yeah. It's tough.
That's a thing that looks good. Not your keto meal prep.
There's some keto meals that look amazing.
Yes.
They just require more effort, I guess.
Oh, it's just adjusting. It just requires a bit of adjusting. Just swapping some ingredients
from
others. Yeah, I love my life.
Doing keto.
I love my life. Chipotle is my life. No, I love it. I think it's the most effective. Like, I've seen a whole change in, like, my energy levels. I've seen a change in, like, my skin. Because I have, like, dermatitis. So, like, sugar. I didn't realize that sugar really, like, flares it up and makes it worse. So, with this diet, all of that has, like, literally gone out the window. I really like it. And I don't feel restricted like I did with other diets and other lifestyles.
Especially now as well, because there's so many, like, there's niches on Instagram and stuff like that where you can just...
Find exactly what you're looking for.
Yeah, and our websites and stuff like that. So you can kind of... And also,
there's so much guidance.
Companies are now making just keto-friendly stuff, so... It's really cool.
Great. I think I don't think it's that hard either. I think once you get used to it, like, you're on it, you know.
Yeah.
It's a lifestyle. It's pretty cool. It's like being vegan.
I wonder if anyone watching is also on a keto, and then you guys could be keto friends.
Oh my God, hit me up. We can talk about cool recipes, like my favorite chocolate cake that went... Oh, by the way, I made a chocolate cake like three days ago, like on the weekend.
Yeah, you shouldn't say you made, because if you said you made, it means it came out all right.
No, but I made it and I murdered it. I think I preheated the oven way too much. So when I put it in, I looked away for like 2 seconds. I looked back in, it was smoking. So it was nasty.
It tasted like burnt chicken.
I don't know why it was sick. Why was it salty? God knows why on earth was salty. It was very disappointing. I felt very bad, but it's okay.
Well, we hope.
I rescued the second pan.
Our father loved it, but he eats anything.
Yeah, he literally
virtually eats everything.
He ate the burnt cake. Yeah. All of it. The whole pan.
And he had the audacity, because I'm here now, so he had the audacity to look at me, have a bite, and say, yeah, it's all right.
I was like, you're eating charcoal.
Yeah, you're literally eating rock.
Virtually just eating charcoal.
But he loves it. I'm pretty sure he put that cake under a, like, under a, what do you call it? Like a fire starter thing? Like what? Like a chimney.
A fire starter.
Yeah. You don't need any wood. Just use that.
It'll it would
yeah, it'll flare yeah, up. Yeah,
probably.
Anyways. We hope you we hope you enjoyed. And for sure, like as I always say, just if you'd like us to check out anything else from Italy, because
any more artists.
I get the feeling
there's a lot more.
Yeah, this is only the surface. So and I love to dive deeper as we have with other countries and stuff like that. And let us know what you'd like for the next podcast, and also would you like us to check out more, because we also have another podcast on Sunday called Feature Friday Plus, in case you're new to the channel, and Feature Friday Extra, which is sort of like all your requests that we check out throughout the week and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So do tune in, and we hope to see you soon.
That's right. And for those who are celebrating again, happy Thanksgiving. Oh. And have a good shopping spree today. I'll see you all soon.
Peace.
Bye-bye.